an enchanted garden, enclosed by tall walls and protected by strong magic, flowed the fountain of fair fortune. Once a year, between the hours of sunrise and sunset on the longest day, a single unfortunate was given the chance to fight their way to the fountain, bathe in its waters, and receive fair fortune forevermore. On the appointed day, hundreds of people traveled from all over the kingdom to reach the garden walls before dawn. Male and female, rich and poor, young and old, of magical means and without, they gathered in the darkness, each hoping that they would be the one to gain entrance to the garden. Three witches, each with her burden of woe, met on the outskirts of the crowd and told one another their sorrows as they waited for sunrise. The first, by name Asha, was sick of a malady no healer could cure. She hoped that the fountain would banish her symptoms and grant her a long and happy life. The second, by name Althea, had been robbed of her home, her gold, and her wand by an evil sorcerer. She hoped that the fountain might relieve her of powerlessness and poverty. The third, by name Mamata, had been deserted by a man whom she loved dearly, and she thought her heart would never mend. She hoped that the fountain would relieve her of her grief and longing. Pitying each other, the three women agreed that, should the chance befall them, they would unite and try to reach the fountain together. The sky was rent with the first ray of sun, and a chink in the wall opened. The crowd surged forward, each of them shrieking their claim for the fountain's benison. Creepers from the garden beyond snakes through the pressing mass, and twisted themselves around the first witch, Asha. She grasped the wrist of the second witch, Althea, who seized tight upon the ropes of the third witch, Amata. And Amata became caught upon the armor of a dismal-looking knight, who was seated on a bone-thin horse. The creepers tugged the three witches through the chink in the wall, and the knight was dragged off his steed after them. The furious screams of the disappointed throng rose upon the morning air, then fell silent as the garden walls sealed once more. Asha and Althea were angry with Amata, who had accidentally brought along the knight. Only one can bathe in the fountain. It will be hard enough to decide which of us it will be, without adding another. Now, Sir Luckless, as the knight was known in the land outside the walls, observed that these were witches, and, having no magic, nor any great skill at jousting or dueling with swords, nor anything that distinguished the non-magical man, was sure that he had no hope, therefore declared his intention of withdrawing outside the walls again. At this, Amato became angry too. Faint heart, she chided him. Draw your sword, knight, and help us reach our goal. And so the three witches and the forlorn knight ventured forth into the enchanted garden, where rare herbs, fruit, and flowers grew in abundance on either side of the sunlit paths. They met no obstacle until they reached the foot of the hill on which the fountain stood. There, however, wrapped around the base of the hill, was a monstrous white worm, bloated and blind. At their approach it turned a foul face upon them, and uttered the following words: "Pay me the proof of your pain." Sir Luckless drew his sword and attempted to kill the beast, but his blade snapped. Then Althea cast rocks at the worm, while Asha and Amaya essayed every spell that might subdue or entrance it. But the power of the ones with no more effective than their friend's stones or the knight's steel, the worm would not let them pass. The sun rose higher and higher in the sky, and Asha, despairing, began to weep. Then the great worm placed its face upon hers and drank the tears from her cheeks. Its thirst assuaged, the worm slithered aside and vanished into a hole in the ground. Rejoicing in the worm's disappearance, the three witches into the night began to climb the hill, sure that they would reach the fountain before noon. Halfway up the steep slope, however, they came across the words cut into the ground before them, "Pay me the fruit of your labors." Sir Luckless took out his only coin and placed it upon the grassy hillside, but it rolled away and was lost. The three witches in the night continued to climb, but though they walked for hours more, they advanced not a step. The summit came no nearer, and still the inscription lay in the earth before them. All were discouraged as the sun rose over their heads and began to sink toward the far horizon, but Althea walked faster and harder than any of them, and exhorted the others to follow her example, though she moved no farther up the enchanted hill. "Courage, friends, and do not yield," she cried, wiping the sweat from her brow. As the drops fell glittering onto the earth, the inscription blocking their path vanished, and they found they were able to move upward once more. Delighted by the removal of this second obstacle, they hurried toward the summit as fast as they could, until at last they glimpsed the fountain, glittering like crystal in a bower of flowers and trees. Before they could reach it, however, they came to a stream that ran around the hilltop, barring their way. In the depths of the clear water lay a smooth stone bearing the words, "Pay me the treasure of your past." Sir Luckless attempted to float across the stream on his shield, but it sank. The three witches pulled him from the water, then tried to leap the brook themselves, but it would not let them cross, and all the while the sun was sinking lower in the sky. So they fell to pondering the meaning of the stone's message, and Amata was the first to understand. Taking her wand, she drew from her mind all the memories of happy times she had spent with her vanished lover, and dropped them into the rushing waters. The stream swept them away, and stepping stones appeared, and the three witches and the knight were able to pass at last onto the summit of the hill. The fountain shimmered before them, set amidst herbs and flowers rarer and more beautiful than any they had yet seen. The sky burned ruby, and it was time to decide which of them would bathe. Before they could make their decision, however, Prelasha fell to the ground. Exhausted by their struggle to the summit, she was close to death. Her three friends would have carried her to the fountain, but Asha was immortal again and begged them not to touch her. Then Althea hastened to pick all those herbs she thought most helpful, and mixed them in Sir Luckless's gourd of water, and poured the potion into Asha's mouth. At once, Asha was able to stand. What was more, all symptoms of her dread malady had vanished. "I am cured," she cried. "I have no need of the fountain. Let Althea bathe." But Althea was busy collecting more herbs in her apron. "If I can cure this disease, I shall earn gold aplenty. Let Amata bathe." Sir Luckless bows and gestured Amata toward the fountain, but she shook her head. The stream had washed away all regret for her lover, and she saw now that he had been cruel and faithless, and that it was happiness enough to be rid of him. "Good sir, you must bathe, as a reward for all your chivalry," she told Sir Luckless. So the knight clanked forth in the last rays of the setting sun, and bathed in the fountain of fair fortune, astonished that he was the chosen one of hundreds, and giddy with his incredible luck. As the sun fell below the horizon, Sir Luckless emerged from the waters with the glory of his triumph upon him, and flung himself and his rusted armor at the feet of Amata. He was the kindest and most beautiful woman he had ever beheld. Flushed with success, he begged for her hand and her heart, and Amata, no less delighted, realized that she had found a man worthy of them. The three witches and the knight set off down the hill together, arm in arm, and all four led long and happy lives. And none of them ever knew or suspected that the fountain's water carried no enchantment at all. Albus Dumbledore on the Fountain of Fair Fortune. The Fountain of Fair Fortune is a perennial favorite, so much so that it was subject of the sole attempt to introduce a Christmas pantomime to Hogwarts festive celebrations. Our then herbology master, Professor Herbert Beery, an enthusiastic devotee of amateur dramatics, proposed a adaptation of the well-beloved children's tale as a Yuletide treat for staff and students. I was then a young transfiguration teacher, and Herbert assigned me to special effects, which included providing a fully functioning Fount of Fair Fortune and a miniature grassy hill, up which our three heroines and hero would appear to march, while it sank slowly into the stage and out of sight. I think I may say, without vanity, that both my fountain and my hill performed the parts allotted to them with simple goodwill. Alas, that the same could not be said of the rest of the cast. Ignoring for a moment the antics of the gigantic worm provided by our care of magical creatures teacher, Professor Sylvanus Kettleburn, the human element proved disastrous to the show. Professor Beery, in his role of director, had been dangerously oblivious to the emotional entanglements seething under his very nose. Little did he know that the students playing on Mutta and Sir Luckless had been boyfriend and girlfriend until 1 hour before the curtain rose, at which point Sir Luckless transferred his affections to Asha. Suffice it to say that out seekers after fair fortune never made it to the top of the hill. The curtain had barely risen when Professor Kettleburn's worm, now revealed to be in a schwindra with an enforcement charm upon it, exploded in a shower of hot sparks and dust, filling the great hall with smoke and fragments of scenery. While the enormous fiery eggs it had laid at the foot of my hill ignited the floorboards, Amada and Asha turned upon each other, dueling so fiercely that Professor Beery was caught in the crossfire, and the staff had to evacuate to hall. As the inferno now raging on stage threatened to engulf the place, the night's entertainment concluded with a packed hospital wing. It was several months before the great hall lost its pungent aroma of wood smoke, and even longer before Professor Beery's head resumed its normal proportions, and Professor Kettleburn was taken off probation. Headmaster Armando Supper imposes a blanket ban on future pantomimes, a proud non-theatrical tradition that Hogwarts continues to this day. Our dramatic fiasco notwithstanding, the Fountain of Fair Fortune is probably the most popular of Beedle's tales, although, just like the Wizard of the Hopping Pot, it has its detractors. More than one parent has demanded the removal of this particular tale from the Hogwarts library, including, by coincidence, a descendant of Brutus Malfoy and one-time member of the Hogwarts Board of Governors, Mr. Lucius Malfoy. Me, Malfoy submitted his demand for a ban on the story in writing. Any work of fiction or non-fiction that depicts interbreeding between wizards and muggles should be banned from the bookshelves of Hogwarts. I do not wish my son to be influenced into sullying the purity of his bloodline by reading stories that promote wizard-muggle marriage. My refusal to remove the book from the library was backed by a majority of the Board of Governors. I wrote back to Mr. Malfoy explaining my decision. So-called pure-blood families maintain their alleged purity by disowning, banishing, or lying about muggles or muggle-nards on their family trees. They then attempt to foist their hypocrisy upon the rest of us by asking us to ban works dealing with the truths they deny. There is not a witch or wizard in existence whose blood has not mingled with that of muggles, and I should therefore consider it both illogical and immoral to remove works dealing with the subject from our students' store of knowledge. This exchange marked the beginning of Mr. Malfoy's long campaign to have me removed from my post as headmaster of Hogwarts, and of mine to have him removed from his position as Lord Voldemort's favorite Death Eater.